I'd like to say it's a great pleasure to introduce today's speaker, but trying to untangle his career has been sort of consuming my morning. Dr. Sean McFate, who is one of our adjuncts, maybe some of you have taken the course, is a Brown graduate who wound up in the 82nd Airborne Division. Now, what I know about Brown and what I know about the 82nd, I just can't keep those two ideas in my head at the same time. And I'm not sure how well he did that either. He tells me he did ROTC at Providence College, though, so I was thinking that Brown had some kind of a closet ranger battalion that nobody's ever heard of. So he's in the Army for 8 years after getting out of Brown, both in the 82nd and then User Europe. Gets out, he tells me he then went to Amnesty International. Okay, 82nd Airborne Division, Amnesty International, another. Maybe you can grab him after the speech and ask him how he managed to do all of that. Went back to Harvard's Kennedy School. Didn't particularly like it, I guess. Wound up going to Dine Corps. Yeah, second-rate school. You know, you work hard. Why would you waste time at Harvard when you could be at Georgetown? Goes to Dine Corp, which hires a lot of former Army, former military, former state. Wreaks havoc in Africa for 3 years, right? I mean, building armies, disarming them, playing with the warlords. No doubt grist for his book, which came out, I guess, about 2 years ago, right? The Modern Mercenary. Goes back to Harvard and finishes, winds up getting his PhD at the London School of Economics. And since then has been a professor at the National Defense University and an adjunct with us. He teaches a course which I highly recommend on the art of grand strategy, which I think takes what we try to teach in 501 and just stretches it way out in creative ways. And then also the U.S. National Security Policy core course. Did you teach anything else for us? No, those are the two? Okay. So, I'm very anxious. Oh, and he's also a novelist, a co-novelist, right? And shamelessly advertising when that should be the title of your presentation. But anyway, maybe that is. Maybe he's going to give you a synopsis.
We'll get back there. Yes.
We'll get there. Anyway, Shadow War is, and the title, Tom Locke Novel, suggests there's going to be plenty of other Tom Locke novels, right? You've got another one already in the oven. Okay, so I really can't think of anybody better qualified from experience, from his intellectual creativity to talk about the future of war than Dr. McFate, and I'm looking forward to what he has to say.
Thank you.
Thanks. Good to see you all. Thanks for spending your lunch hour. So this is not just a shameless plug, but we'll get back to you, okay? We'll get back to this novel. I'll start this way. About 10 years ago, I was sitting at a table drinking a Coke. Across from me was the president of Burundi. Next to him was the U.S. ambassador, an American woman who I presume to be the CIA chief of station, and the president's 8-year-old daughter. And we were sitting watching TV in his mansion, and nobody was saying a word. Because the reason I was there was to stop a genocide. So we all remember the Burundi and Rwanda genocide of 1994. 800,000 people killed in 90 days, which makes ISIS look like amateur hour, right? There was the US intelligence community had tangible or good intel that there would be an assassination attempt on this president, and if that had occurred, another genocide would likely unfold in sort of the reprisal killing tornado. That's how the first genocide was enacted, and this is how the second was planned to be enacted. The only problem is that nobody in the room, including myself, had any idea how to do this. Now you might think, well, I was working for the agency. Or maybe I was working for SOCOM. But I was not. I was working for a multinational corporation. And to this day, this is not a story that's told for some obvious reasons. But this is increasingly how our foreign policy is being enacted these days, through the private sector and through other actors. And so this kind of led to a couple of things. Now, how does one end up doing this type of thing? This is me, way back in the day. I was a paratrooper in the 82nd Airborne Division. And then one day, I left and I did some other things. And I was at Harvard contemplating what I thought may have been the worst mistake of my life by going to grad school and doing problem sets for econ and stats and stuff like that. And I get this phone call from a company called Dyncorp International. Has anybody heard of Dyncorp? Okay, not a small company, it's a $4 billion company. Who, they do a lot of innocuous things, or like, you know, airplane maintenance and stuff like that. But they have a special wing of like the quote other. And I was in that. And they gave me a call one day and said, you know, short version of this, you know, we need to raise an army in Africa. We think you can help us. Would you consider dropping out of your graduate program to do so? I was like, yes, of course. Of course. And that led to what I initially thought it'd be like, you know, a couple months, and, you know, 3 years. And doing strange things. You know, basically raising small armies for U.S. interest abroad. Things that you would think would be the purview of government. That would be, quote, inherently governmental. But these things are increasingly outsourced to the private sector. This is me working with warlords in West Africa. Contractors sometimes can do things we don't want USG personnel to do. This is me doing the Victor Bat Run, or Boot Run. Who is Victor Boot? Does anyone know? Who is?
Arms dealer.
So he was this famous arms dealer. Anyone see Lord of War? He was, you know, that movie is somewhat is loosely based on him. Famous arms dealer, and this is, you know, me doing the Victor Boot Run, going to Eastern Europe, going on a shopping spree, hauling things back, legally, in AN-12, into West Africa. It's the only thing that works efficiently, in my opinion, in both Eastern Europe and West Africa, is the arms trade. It's like, boom, it's like Switzerland. Everything just, like, moves. Everybody knows what they're doing. It's none of this sort of, sometimes if you spend time in those places, that's, things don't always work out well, this always works out well. Me working, quote unquote, with the United Nations. Also having access to groups that USG personnel sometimes don't have access to for information. And with my buds, and this is sort of why I sent the picture back to the academic dean of the Kennedy School. Having a great time out here. To my boys, it's up to general naughtiness. This is what sort of military contractors, so I would say mercenaries, do on their off time, and guns and golf and beer. So this is a sort of an introduction to talk about how war is changing. This is a moniker we hear all the time in this town, but in my opinion, so much of it is completely wrong. Due to a failure of strategic imagination. We're still looking to fight symmetrical wars against near-peer state powers using technology. You know, the last 50 years, we've arguably been defeated by Luddites. So why are we still focusing on this? Well, I don't want to spend today talking about that question about strategic culture. I'm just laying it out there, right? In the last 10 years, we're seeing the proliferation of mercenaries, starting with Iraq. It's no longer just a US phenomenon. Putin is using them in places like Ukraine. And you know what? So are Ukraine oligarchs against his mercenaries. We're seeing them in Syria, from all over the world. These are some Russian mercenaries, or so we're told. Nigeria, interesting story. This is all this last year, by the way. This is not ancient history. So for the last 6 years, the Nigerian military, not an incapable military, has been struggling against Boko Haram. Last year, they hired mercenaries to augment them, and they pushed Boko Haram mostly out of the country in weeks. And these mercenaries, they're not just like the lone guy in the jungle with a Kalashnikov. They show up with attack helicopters, right? You can rent attack helicopters. Just think about that. For any reason you want to. Yemen. So Abu Dhabi hired a bunch of ex-soft guys from Latin America, which are both very capable veterans who fight, you know, are cheap, to go kill Houthis in Yemen, to prosecute the war in Yemen. Mercenaries are a great way for rich countries or clients who don't want to bleed to have fighting power. We're seeing shipping lines hire them to counter pirates in the Gulf of Aden, the Gulf of Guinea. This is called embark security. These are like, what happens is, these are like basically privateers, which are mercenaries of the sea, and they sit in an arsenal ship, like a mothership in the Gulf of Aden, a pirate water, and if you pay a fee and you're a shipping line, they will helicopter over basically a squad of marines to sit on your ship as it goes through pirate water, fighting off pirates. This industry is based mostly in London, okay? And it's tacitly encouraged by the US Navy because they don't want to send an Aegis cruiser after a Zodiac, right? So this is an industry. Now, out of work privateers do what? Yes, they become actors in Hollywood. No, they out of work privateers become pirates, just like out of work mercenaries become bandits. We also have mercenaries in cyberspace. They're called hackback companies. Has anybody heard of a hackback company? Hackback. So the way a hackback company works is that these are hackers that you hire. So just say you're an insurance company, and you don't want to be hacked, because that would be disastrous for you, right? So what the current law, as it reads in the United States, means you can only play defense, you can't play offense, but what if you have, you know, Russia or China attackers hacking you, and you can't afford, or you decide you don't want to just be on defense, you need to go after them. So you hire these hackers to hack those who hack you. Now, they can't recover your stolen data, but the idea, at least in theory, is that they act as a deterrent. So if you're a Russian hacking or Chinese hacking crew and you see one target as a hackback company and another target doesn't, you hack the one that doesn't. That's how the theory should work. But you're seeing this private force, if you will, emerge in, you know, 4 out of the 5 domains of war. Land, sea, air, because you can take drones and they can kamikaze drones. Space, we don't see it in space, not yet. We've seen privatized spaceflight. And then fifth domain is cyber. It's proliferating. And this is important because mercenaries change warfare. They change who, how, and why we fight. And if we're getting to an era where anybody who can afford the means of war can wage it for whatever reason they want, you're going to see potentially oil companies with their own private army. You're going to see the United Nations or a philanthropist hiring them to do humanitarian interventions. The sky's the limit, and that will change world order as we know it. So this is changing warfare. The privatization of war is changing warfare. This is not a new phenomenon. I don't want to go into the history of it. But you know, people say that mercenaries are the second oldest profession. And it's actually been an anomaly that the last couple centuries, states have had the monopoly of force. It's been an utter anomaly in history of warfare. We're returning to the status quo ante of that. So to get at this, though, I've tried to fashion a course that reimagines strategy. Because we're in a town where everybody's still thinking about, you know, fourth generation offset, stuff like that, which is a very old school way of thinking. So how do we create, how do we reimagine strategy? And the first thing to know about strategy is that strategic thinking is critical thinking. So strategic surprise shows the failure to think strategically. It shows the failure to have strategic imagination. I'm quite harsh on this. So the course, the seminar, it's a graduate seminar, we begin with what is critical thinking? Okay, how's it different than engineering thinking? And then we look at our strategic culture in this country. So if you graduate from, say, let's say West Point, and you're an English major, what kind of degree do you hold?
It's a Bachelor of Science.
A Bachelor of Science degree, even though you're an English major. Our academies, our sort of the way we educate officers, for good reason, is sort of an engineering model, for some very good reasons, which works really well at the tactical level of warfare, but less well at the strategic level of warfare. And that's what we're doing here. Now I'm just going to talk to you briefly about a couple of things in the course, then we'll get back to the future war. So Clausewitz, right? The prophet. Clausewitz, we begin with Clausewitz. How can you not? He is the most quoted yet least understood man in the Pentagon. Right? People conflate, oh, absolute war, what's it mean, this, and he's given us a strategic lexicon, but it's like what people like, it's like kids with vocab cards not knowing how to use them correctly. So the first thing that we do in this course is sort of demystify Herr Clausewitz. He was great at some things, and other things he kind of was not so great at. You could argue that Clausewitz was not even a strategic thinker, because the majority of his book on war is about military operational art of the 18th and 19th century, right? But he does give us a strategic lexicon that you, and I encourage all my students to become national security advisors in the future. When you become the NSA, you will be able to speak this and understand this lexicon. But his big idea is the utility of force as a political weapon. There's a lot of big ideas. We're not going to unpack this. This is a whole semester. But he's not alone. Before there was Clausewitz, there was Germany. Now, from like the 19th century and up to 1970, it was all about Germany. It wasn't about Clausewitz. Nobody had heard of Clausewitz. And now it's the opposite. Now it's all about Clausewitz. Nobody's heard of Germany. And Clausewitz, and Germany is like, he has like a very prescriptive view of how to do war. And Clausewitz is sort of, that's baloney. You can't, you know, war is too complex to have sort of laws, like Renaissance laws. But in truth, our military doctrine today is a hybrid of these two. So principles of war, that's Germanian thinking. All right, then there's Sun Tzu. Now Sun Tzu is often taught like the fortune cookie of strategy, right? That most people do not get. And it's hard to read. We talk about this in the class. But the truth is, you cannot understand Sun Tzu unless you understand ancient Chinese Taoism. Right? So we have to unpack Taoism. And if you think about Taoism, it's a little bit like Star Wars, The Force. You know, it's like Yoda when he gives that, like, you know, the, everything around you is the Force, and you know, not this crude matter, but just, you know, Luke's shoulder. And so he has a completely different view of strategy versus Clausewitz. And so we discussed that. Like, Clausewitz hates Intel, and he loves it. These two are in dialogue with each other. And so it's hard to understand Clausewitz unless you have some sort of counterbalance like Sun Tzu. The problem is, he's usually taught very poorly. He's taught poorly in the war college system, I can tell you that. And then there's Kautilya. Anybody read Kautilya? Kautilya. So this is, if you were in India or Pakistan, you'd be reared on Kautilya. He is a different view. He's like primacy. Security through hegemony. And he tells you how to do it. And his strategy has not just military operations, but like how to tax the population. Economics, all that stuff. And his diplomacy makes Machiavelli look pretty tame. Machiavelli looks pretty tame. So we discuss Kautilya. Who's really interesting, what we know of him. Okay, so this is great, right? But today you have the weak defeating the strong. And this is the war of the future. So how does this work? How does this work? So we talk about Mao, right? Mao tells us how the weak can defeat the strong. He's got this almost this great formula. It always generally works. Strategies aren't politics. So pay attention to the politics and not the arms, right? Now, Clausewitz says this. That's the quote from Clausewitz. Like, what's Clausewitz's quote that we should all... every Clausewitzian should, in his deathbed, should, or her deathbed, should whisper the worst policy by the means. Yes. He's like, yeah, let's operationalize that. Okay? T. Lawrence, the same thing. He tells you how to operationalize it. He talks about how war, you know, if you're a guerrilla, you know, if you're an army, you're a potted plant. Why do you want to fight head on head, if you're a guerrilla force? You're like vapor. Be like vapor, right? We discussed this. But so how do you defeat this? And here's what we bring up to today. Galula, this French Tunisian guy. His idea, from Rand, gave this what we now kind of counterinsurgency manual. But here's the catch. This is why I think I'm very critical of American coin, is that counterinsurgency that he created was not about nation building and democracy promotion, it was about how to reestablish colonialism. Those two are not compatible. And the hybrid that we've made of that, at least in my mind, is sort of a dog's breakfast of coin and why it cannot succeed. These are not compatible objectives. So when he talks about establishing, a new regime, he's also talking about, not having a free press, about arguably targeted assassinations against political opposition, but all these things that we don't do. Then lastly, some case studies. The Peloponnesian War, which is a really difficult case study, but it's part of our strategic lexicon. The American Revolutionary War, from the point of view of Mao, was Washington and Maoist. And then some things that we don't know what they are. The 2006 Lebanon War, which arguably Hezbollah won, against a vastly superior military force. How did they do it? And things like the Liberian War in West Africa. Is this even war? And this is the frontier of today. Is this war? So we're no longer doing World War II. We should be looking at stuff like over here. All right? So, bringing this back to what we're here to talk about today is that where is the war of tomorrow going to look like? Where's it going to be? What's it going to look like? Now, sometimes it's easier to talk about this stuff in the form of fiction than nonfiction, which is why I wrote this book. This book began as a memoir, as autobiography. And then my agent was like, you should make it fiction so you don't get sued to death. So I did. And you can have more fun. But really this book, it's a series of novels based on, it's sort of a Tom Clancy-like airport read. It's not literature, it's just fun. But it lays a very different vision for the future of war than, say, other books out there. So there's a lot of popular books out there. They're very sort of, very Westphalian, very World War II, Boy Scout, CIA guy, takes down evil enemy, 007 style. That's not what the world's going to look like, in my opinion. So let's talk about the future of war, and then we'll just open up to questions. In this book, in this novel series, the first thing is that there will never be symmetry in warfare. It's delusional that we want to fight an enemy who wants to fight like us. That's delusional, right? So why do we keep on talking about this? How many F-22s or F-35s fought in the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan? We have a new aircraft carrier. What's it going to do, right? Not cheap propositions. The second is technology will not save us. As I mentioned earlier, since the Vietnam War up to today, we've struggled against those with very low tech. So I don't, in the 1990s we had this thing called the RMA, the Revolution of Military Affairs, about how technology we can leapfrog ahead of our adversary. Well, that violates rule number one, right? So technology will not save us. Part of our strategic culture, however, fetishizes technology, which is strategically distracting. Third, states matter less. Now, this is not new. Since the end of the Cold War, people have talked about the rise of globalization, other forces that are making states matter less. And that's okay, because states had a beginning, a middle, and they may have an end. They are not timeless and universal. They began sometime 1300s, 1400s, 1500s in Europe and were exported to colonization. And the idea that they're universal and timeless is something that I think a lot of people in the world, if you go to South Asia, Africa, they would say, or Middle East, I don't get it. I mean, the Middle East is balkanizing right now, right? 4, warriors are masked nowadays and may not fight for states. This is not just terrorism. This is also mercenaries. It's also narcos. There's all sorts of categories of people out there, not just terrorism. The little green men in Ukraine, right? Well, they fight for Russia, we're told. We don't really know. 5, laws of war, international law, matter not, if it even ever mattered at all. International law is interstate. The war of laws of war is interstate warfare. You know, I don't know. I mean, it's possible that India and Pakistan could go to war. So there's possibles for interstate warfare. But most of the wars we're seeing around the world are not sort of World War II-ish interstate wars. There will be a market for force with mercenaries. The proverbial genie has left the bottle. We can't put it back in. This means that anybody who can afford war can wage it for whatever reason they want. There'll be new actors on the stage, like multinational corporations, the super rich, who can fight for any reason they want. That will change warfare, which means others will be fighting wars. It could be a cartel, it could be a company, it could be, you know, some really rich person. 8 is plausible deniability. So Putin could take over Ukraine with his Russian army if he wanted to. So why is he skulking around with little green men, proxy militia, and mercenaries, and cyber? Because in a globalized information age, this is much more powerful. How can you, as the US, rally the international community to fight Russia and Ukraine if you can't even prove that they're there to begin with? It's a brilliant defense on behalf of Putin. So in the future, in an information age, plausible deniability may be more important than steel on target. 9, hearts and matters matter less. We can come back to that. Winning hearts and minds, you know, looking at Iraq and Afghanistan, it's contested. And lastly, there will be more war. Not high-intensity war like World War II, or maybe a potential World War III, but the low-grade, persistent, durable war that we're seeing around the world, especially if you have a market for force, because mercenaries are incentivized to start and expand warfare for profit, right? So I try to capture this in this book, what this would look like, where you have multinational corporations hiring mercenaries to do things in foreign lands, and other states doing the same thing against them, and all these sort of different layers of war and different actors. It's like Tom Clancy, but with a different viewpoint. It's done fairly well. I leave that there because I want to have a chance to have a discussion. I don't want to sit here and talk. I want to tell you about my background as to how I came to do this. The course I'm running here as part of this, of like how do we reimagine strategy for the future and this future vision for what warfare may look like. And with that, I would turn it over to you. Hopefully it's provocative enough for conversation. Yes?
Your claims there on the last page.
Yeah, let me go back.
Probably have a lot of interesting ethical considerations, moral considerations for states, individuals, international organizations.
Yeah.
Do you talk about, or could you talk about now a little bit, some of the major ethical implications that you think your findings, if they happen to come true, would be?
Yeah. No, you raise a great point. And I talked to General Dubik about this for obvious reasons. And a lot of the students in my seminar then go on and take General Dubik's course, I think to cleanse their brain of my evilness. I actually, in the course, I bracket this important question, ethics of war. But I think the point you raise, I mean, mercenaries raise a lot of ethical issues, obviously. When you link profit motive to killing and to war, evil things happen. It expands warfare and makes it much more complex than it already is. In this book, I am silent on it. I let the reader kind of judge. I put things out there. So the book is based on things I've actually done and seen. Some of the things are really questionable. And the main character, Tom Locke, who's like, it's like me if I'd stayed in that world, except he's much more badass and much more damaged. He's conflicted by this too, but maybe not to the degree that you would be satisfied. You'd like, keep, you know, you should, and as frankly, as the series goes on, he'll become more conflicted and change. But yeah, I think that, you know, only bad things can happen to this. However, let's not kid ourselves about, you know, state-on-state warfare produced World War I and World War II and the Holocaust. So let's not cavil too much about, you know, the evilness and wickedness of mercenaries when state war, like, and also, who would you rather be a POW at, Blackwater or the Zimbabwe Army? So, you know, I mean, I think it goes both ways. I mean, we all remember Nisour Square, but who remembers Haditha? So Nisour Square, Blackwater squad killed 17 civilians in Iraq, and nothing happened to them until very recently, and it's still very scandalous. But in 2005, a squad of Marines did something far worse. They had revenge killings. They killed not 17, but 23, and DOD swept it under the rug. Nobody seems to care about Haditha, so Marines, you could argue that the Blackwater guys are held to a higher ethical standard than the Marines. I'm not making an argument, but somebody could argue that. So I think it's actually, it's already quite complex, but you raise a very good point. Yes?
You described the Westphalian state probably matters less, and I so like you left us with this like chaotic prediction. Do you have a like state system in mind which might take over or kind of replace the Westphalian system?
I do, but it doesn't involve states. How's that sound? So I think what's happening, and I talk about this in my nonfiction book, The Modern Mercenary. it draws on the theory of Hedley Bull, international relations theorist, and basically that we're going back to the rise of mercenaries is a symptom, not a cause, that we're going back to a pre-Westphalian time. I look at European Middle Ages, where you had overlapping claims of authority and sovereignty between states and non-state actors. So when one of the biggest superpowers in the Middle Ages was the Catholic Church. They're not a state. I mean, states are not all forms of political organization. They are a type of political organization. And in the Middle Ages, you had bishops, you had the Pope, you had emperor, you had princes, you had city-states, all making claims on the same peasants and same land all the time. I think we're going back to that and the politics of identity surrounding that. And so it's a messy system, but it won't disappear like, you know, the Knights of Nice and Monty Python. It'll just be a durable disorder, and I think we're seeing that emerge in the world today, a durable disorder.
John, let me.
Yeah.
East Asia is a state system.
Yeah.
Pretty strong nation state.
Yes.
China's pushing around its neighbors. I could imagine a conflict between the U.S. and China at some level that would defy almost all of these rules.
Sure.
And it would be a big, very dangerous war.
Yeah.
So how do you fit that into your
No, theory? It's true. So. Okay, interstate conflict can occur in East Asia. It can occur in South Asia between Pakistan and India. And maybe some version with Russia, right? Although I think that's could be a little different. But if you look at the vast majority of conflicts in the world, they don't look like that. So then how do you measure that? Like, you know, one conflict. Not all conflicts are equal, so there's a lot of problems with that. So I think that, you know, much of the world looks like this, much of the continents, and I think East Asia, is that exceptional? Is this not a part of the world where these rules apply less? So I'm not saying that all war will be like this, but I think we are focused on a certain type of warfare when much of the world looks like this. And much of the actors aren't even states. And then, like, who are they? It's not just ISIS. There's other types of actors too. So that's my bigger point, is that we think about war in a very sort of Westphalian way. So I'm trying to think of it as a little bit non-Westphalian. Yes?
Just to follow up with that point, I guess, you know, we do tend to see warfare as either being like this or being a state on state kind of conflict.
Yeah.
If we look at maybe what China is doing with their maritime militias in the East China Sea, South China Sea, using something more like this, but to achieve those traditional state on state power goals or even territorial claims, which is a very state-like behavior.
Yeah.
Do you see that as sort of indication that that might be like a stepping stone towards the future you've described, or is that type of hybridization a different character of world altogether?
Well, I think if you look at what Putin has done, he's a powerful state, but he's fighting, his wars look more like this. His sort of game plan now is, it's not like Hungary, the Czech Republic in 56, 68, you don't walk in there with tanks. What you do is you destabilize the country using subversion and have a velvet regime change, and then now it's your proxy client state. That looks more like this, and I think you could do both. I mean, it's not an either or, but I think also, the thing I want to highlight here is that we tend to look at some conflicts as law enforcement, others as war. So narcos is an example of this. You know, narcos kill a lot more Americans every year than ISIS does. Yet somehow we put them in a different box and bin, which is kind of mysterious to me. So the question is, if we're seeing a lot of this occur on our borders, like south of the borders, or against Putin, maybe we should be doing some of this as well. And that's contrary to our strategic culture. And that's kind of my own subversive agenda, is try to, how could we be doing this? And let's not just rely on soft and Title 50 ops. I mean, maybe it needs to be a little bit wider than that. I don't know. I'm just laying it out there. Back here. Question back here? Go here. And back there.
So I guess with your prescription then, given how the United States isn't just going to dissolve, at least in the near term as we see it, would your prescription be for the next 20 to 30 years for the U.S. military to be more soft, more Title 50 or what have you? What would your prescription be to kind of deal with this?
Well, I think some of the most effective weapons don't fire bullets. So I think I'd look at that, like, first of all, non-DOD instruments of power. I would look at information. We're really bad at information warfare, and there's some good reasons. We're a democracy. There's something called the Smith-Monct Act, which prevents us from propagandizing, Americans abroad or here. How do we weaponize economics? USA doesn't want to be a part of that for some very good reasons. So I think there's a lot of, I think it's not just a DOD thing. I think we broaden it wider. And yeah, people look at turn to soft as the magic bullet too. And I don't think that is fair to soft. And I think soft would be foolish to sort of want to do everything. And also the question, how many special operators can you have? I mean, at some point it becomes less special. So the points you raise are good ones. One of the great things about being a novelist, besides not having to use footnotes, which feels kind of dirty, is that you don't have to answer tough questions like this. But the novel is really kind of it's like a playground to toss out some ideas without responsibility. Yeah.
So we know, for example, that during the Cold War, we had a lot of proxy conflicts where one side or another was pumping money in, pumping arms in. We know that, the 1970s to the 80s, we had kind of the golden age of terrorism for that wave where there were the most incidents in recent history. And that, states have been sponsoring these terrorist actors at least since that time period. And so how new would you say the phenomenon is of states using non-state actors to accomplish their political objectives?
Well, proxy warfare is an ancient strategy, right? It's a question of how you use it. So how Putin is using proxy warfare in Georgia and Ukraine, how he might use it in Estonia, I think is an interesting model to think about. We use Sons of Iraq in Anbar province in 2007-89. Arguably, are they mercenary or not? I don't think they are, but you could have that discussion. and you look at many people, look at what Hezbollah is doing, etc. So proxy war is not new. I guess the question is, how is it being used today? Are we doing it? Should we be doing it more? If so, what should it look like? I think it should look more, the US using private military companies in Iraq was not, in my opinion, a conscientious decision. It sort of ended up that way, like so many things in Iraq. It just evolve that way. Should there be more of that, or should there be less of that? I mean, that's the type of, I want to bring proxy warfare up to the current contemporary age. And also, we're not the only ones using it. It's not just state and state. So you have multinationals doing this stuff, too, right? And that's different. Yes?
You talked a bit about the back hackers, but I was wondering if you can expound on like cyber mercenaries,
mm-hmm.
because we already have so many problems with like attribution,
sure.
cybersecurity. How do you think that would impact the way states deal with things in terms of cyber war or just groups or incentives for hackers?
I think one of the key things is attribution. And this is also why states sometimes like to use mercenaries or private military contractors, whatever you call them, because they can always say, we don't know who did it. So if you ask Nigeria, who are those strange South African guys hanging out of helicopters attacking Boko Haram? They're like, we don't know who they are. And so it's the same problem as cyber. Now, if you enter, like, if hackback companies, right now it's very controversial, and the White House recently said no hackback companies. That might change, depending on how much pressure they have, again, this multinationals have. And of course, it'll make everything more complicated. I mean, and also, what happens if, you know, what do unemployed mercenaries do? They can go into business for themselves. And that's the other problem, is that you can get into security rackets. So, you know, in the Middle Ages, when mercenaries were very common, contract war was very common, what out-of-work mercenaries would go to a city like Siena, surround it and say, give us 5,000 pounds of gold or we will sack your city. And so the citizens scramble, they hunk over 5,000 pounds of gold, and the mercenary band says, great, we'll be back next month, right? So if you have an industry vested in conflict, it breeds conflict, whether that's terrestrial-based or cyber-based. And I think that's a huge concern. And the other thing about mercenaries is that you cannot regulate them. I mean, it's international law, but mercenaries can shoot back. They can kill your law enforcement, right? I mean, who's going to arrest the mercenaries in Syria? So we have a big problem here because this market across the domains of war is proliferating and evolving and diversifying. Yes, I'll go here. Yeah.
So I have two questions about a couple of the points up on the screen. The
sure.
First is, if international law doesn't apply in point 5, then why are states like Russia and Ukraine, for example, denying what is unlawful intervention and denying that they're even doing that in the first place? And then the second question is, if mines and harps don't matter, why do we see states engaging in this kind of information war, propaganda, again, that we're seeing in Russia?
That's the second's a good point. So the first, I'll lay my cards on the table and tell you I'm an international law skeptic, if you haven't gathered that already. I think international law is diplomacy. It's a set of non-binding treaties and customs between states. States invoke them cynically when it benefits them. And the U.S. saying a pillar of its core strategy is a law, you know, a rule of law international society. Well, it's great if you're the U.S. and you've created the system to benefit you, but if you're a small state or China, that's not such an appealing society to belong to. So I think, you know, which is why I think we see China and Russia, one hand, will speak out of both sides of the mouth. When it conveniences them, they'll invoke international law, and when it doesn't, they'll ignore it. And frankly, are we so different? So that's my opinion, that's my bias. I'm being very candid with you. And agree to disagree, that's fine. Now, in terms of hearts and minds, I'm also a skeptic about this. You know, Sri Lanka was very successful in its insurgency by, frankly, I'm not defending this, it's not an ethical question, to your point. They wiped out the Tamils,
yeah.
Right? After 23 years of doing all sorts of coin strategies of one sort or another, they just wiped them out, and they've achieved stability. Now, leaving ethics aside, which is a very serious ethical concern, I think hearts and minds, I think it's employed cynically in a sort of a Machiavellian or Cotillian sense. When it's useful, but I don't think that you can't tell me that in Iraq and Afghanistan, when we fought very hard to achieve hearts, you know, hearts and minds, what it gave us. That's a contentious statement. I understand this, but that's my thinking. At least that's in it comes out in the book too. Yes,
I wanted to talk a little bit more about hearts and minds. In that, sure, when you're aiming for, like, kind of like you were talking about Galula and how he invokes it as sort of like to achieve sort of colonial goals or state-based goals.
Mm-hmm.
But in the sort of framework that you're talking about, I would say hearts and minds do matter, just not from the perspective of the state, because when you talk about mobilization, when you talk about mercenary networks,
mm-hmm.
informal ties, kinship ties, I think hearts and minds matter arguably more.
Though you both raised great points. So let me qualify my statement. Hearts and minds matter for political organization, and especially if you're talking about an armed social movement, which is often what conflict is, right? The difference, though, is that hearts and minds in the coin context is problematic because we have this assumption, because we based our sense of legitimacy on social contract theory, that the ruled give their consent to be ruled in a sort of a Locke Hobbes framers the Constitution way. But that doesn't work in societies that don't share that framework of legitimacy, like political Islam, where legitimacy is conferred by piety and not by a social contract. So the idea that we can give a hospital and services and security to these people and they will give us their allegiance is a completely flawed proposition, utterly flawed, which is why it doesn't work, unless you're dealing with a country that's Democrat in the way that we're Democrat, like, I don't know, England or something today. So that's why I think hearts and minds don't matter. So it's really within that context of U.S. coin and nation building. Yeah.
Just to kind of follow up on it, maybe for my sake to clarify, when I think of hearts and minds, I think of it kind of broadly in the ability to influence opinions and decisions. So when you're using it there, and from what you said in the coin context, do you mean it more in terms of how we've come to operationalize that by doing like specifically aid and development projects as a stability effort? What do you mean?
So hearts and minds, and so one of the difference between Galula and Petraeus is this, whether Petraeus would say this or not, I don't know, is that Galula talks about, you know, if he takes Mao from what Mao said, it's just like, it's not about the war, stupid, it's about political society. And that's how you win. And to do that, you need to create your own political social movement to counter the insurgents. And to do that, you need to control the narrative of the conflict. You need to lace the press with good news stories and stuff like that. In coin, as we practice it, we can't do that because we're also trying to create democracy in a sovereign state, and one of the pillars of that is a free press. Now this got us into huge trouble in 2005 when the New York Times and LA Times discovered that SOCOM had paid a company to lace the Iraqi press with good news US stories, right? So that is one of the examples, I think, of narrative and hearts and minds. To actually achieve this, you've got to do things that our coin manual is unwilling to go, or at least I think so. Well, it's not acceptable in the end ways means. So this is a conflict we have with coin. Yeah?
I think one of the kind of implications going down the list is that also, based on this list, is that warfare is then going to become extremely more violent and deadly because, and I think this is a problem kind of the U.S. is dealing with, is, you know, through history, countries would surrender because at that point they were, you know, the military is defeated, they're no longer able to defend their population. You could essentially line up their population and kill
them. Sure.
If, you know, to win now, countries, at least like the U.S., we won't do that.
Well, you're right.
Reason for a country to surrender or stop fighting.
So conflict termination under this circumstance becomes really problematic.
Yeah.
Especially when some of the military actors are for profit. I mean, like, and that's their principal reason to fight. So there's a, you know, first of all, economic incentives have always played a role in individual fighters' incentive structure. So we have soldiers who get $40,000 reenlistment bonuses if they have they speak Pashto. Does that make them a mercenary? No, it doesn't make them a mercenary, because their principal reason is probably not to do that. We have suicide bombers whose families might get some compensation, right? The types of military actors I'm talking about are principally motivated by money. And to them, warfare, they are market actors, and the market is war. And that shapes strategy in different ways, because suddenly now, the strategies of Wall Street can apply to warfare. It's like Adam Smith meets CrossFits, where you can do, you know, yeah, there's different types of strategies that are alien to military commanders that are probably common to international business lawyers and CEOs that now could apply in this type of warfare to strategy. Question, yeah.
So you talked about technology mattering less and not being able to save us. And I think that's true for a lot of the conflicts that you've talked about. But at the highest level of technology, and I'm absolutely talking about nukes, you kind of play for keeps.
Yeah.
So if we forego development of technology, aren't we kind of risking a lot there?
Well, I'm not advocating foregoing it. And as Tom was saying too, that this doesn't apply to war everywhere. This, you know, this applies to war in many places, but not, I would say, in East Asia, right? Nukes are a strange dynamic with warfare. And you know, who's gonna be the person to break the nuclear taboo, right? One of my concerns is, you know, a World War I Sarajevo moment in the Middle East between Saudi Arabia, Iran, and Israel potentially was an accidental escalation of war that goes nuclear, or maybe with Pakistan and India. So you're correct. I'm not saying we should forego technology, but our, you know, the money we spent on trying to defeat IEDs through technology was immense, and arguably not very effective. We have this technology, I think this mule, this like robot mule in MIT. Have you ever seen this thing? It's, you know, it's like gigantic. You put your rucksacks on it and it can stumble around the woods, but it sounds like a chainsaw. Can you imagine like special like seals creeping along with a chainsaw following them? Like, get a regular mule. Why do you need this robotic mule? My point is that we fetishize technology. I think this has to do with our country's 19th century roots as inventors and, you know, stuff like that. And the role of nuclear weapons, of course, is a very important one. But I think less, you know, we don't need another aircraft, arguably we do. I would say we don't need another aircraft carrier. That was it George W. Bush aircraft carrier right now with UC trials? Gerald Ford, yeah.
Due out in a year now.
What's that?
Due out in a year.
Yeah, they're doing testing, right? Yeah. Any year, any decade. Anyway, I don't know. I mean, that's a debate. I mean, if war, parts of war is going to look more like this, then we're not investing this at all. This is a cheap investment. Of course, there's ethical issues and there's other things it messes with. I'm not really advocating we do this. I'm not saying we should fight Putin like Putin, but we need to think about what the force of the future might look like if this is at least partially the strategic context we might be finding ourselves in. So that would be less technology-focused, but not obliterating it.
My concern is that if we equip ourselves for that one kind of war at the expense of traditional kinds of war, it'll be harder to resolve a conflict, which, even if less likely, has unacceptable negative consequences in the event of failure.
Well, sure, but I don't think it's an either-or proposition. I think right now we're balancing heavily towards one type of war, quote-unquote traditional warfare. And I think that there's interests in town that have anything to do with warfare that are also driving this too. And that's my other concern. So for the last, like for example, in the military, last decade, year, you know, we can't say decade of war anymore, more than a decade of war, people said how important FAOs are, foreign area officers, who get language training and specialized cultural training, and they learn about an area. Like, we need more FAOs. But now that we're out of Iraq, like, FAOs, like, where are the FAOs? You know, like, nobody's training them. So that's, I think we need our investment. If you read the QDR, to me, it reads like a shopping list for Lockheed Martin. And I think we need to get away from that and think about warfare that's non-traditional. We need to think about things like narcos, are, you know, things that stretch, you know, see how plastic our boundaries are about what it means to have armed conflict today. What is war today? I think having this idea of John Wayne taking the beach is, I think we have to move beyond that at some point. That's what I think where a lot of I have some strong opinions about this, but look, I'll say one last example, like cyber. You're more likely to be hurt by falling over furniture than by cyber, right? But all the hoopla about cyber, if you ask a cyber expert, what's cyber? You cannot get 10 experts to agree, other than ones and zeros in space. And so there's a lot of, yet we love cyber. It's another example of a federalization of warfare and technology. Not saying cyber is not an issue, but I think we give it way more relevance than it deserves or demands. But we can bring the challenge in that. Yeah. Other questions? Yes.
Can you talk about the implications on peacekeeping, if any?
Well, that's a great question. Well, so I think for those who've worked in the UN, the UN is teetering right now for a lot of reasons. UN peacekeeping missions are beyond capacity. There's donor fatigue. There's a lot of problems. One of the things that actually could help the United Nations, in my opinion, is if it considered a strict vetting and sort of accountability program to hire private military contractors to augment standing peacekeeping missions under some very specific preconditions and qualifications. So it's not a blank check. And also, I think it would help normalize the industry to weed out good actors from bad actors. So to get like a UN clean bill of health, you've got to do certain things that are monitored with accountability. And I think that is an example of where this industry, number six here, could really be a boon for international stability rather than just be a plague upon it, which is right now what we're going to, because we're doing nothing to limit this growing market for force.
So you mentioned the phrase privateers and your proposal right there to kind of normalize the state of affairs by bringing these mercenaries into a state system, giving them actual, identifiable state sanction, kind of reminds me of that concept as well. Do you think that we can move to such a system? And what do you think such a system would look like if we were able to give these kinds of PMC state sanctions?
Well, so Congress actually is authorized to give letters of marque to privateer vessels. No, we haven't done that. So letter of marque means that you give it, there's a private navy, and you say, here's a letter of marque. You know, if you see any, just pick your enemy, Iranian ship in the Hormuz Straits, you are authorized to go after it as if you were a U.S. Navy vessel, and you get all the rights, you get to keep the booty and have the rights and privileges of a U.S. Navy vessel for this situation. Or actually better yet, pirates off of Somalia. And arguably that would save the U.S. Navy from having to go after Zodiacs. The bigger question is what happens when the letter of marque is finished, right? Then what happens to that private vessel? They go look for other work. And if they can't find, and that could be working for the pirates that they were just chasing, right? And this has actually happened. There's a company called Somcan in Somalia that was fighting pirates off of Somalia and then was working with the pirates against Somaliland government. So that's the big concern about private force. And one of the questions is how do we get rid of private force? Like, private force was a key aspect of military warfare throughout all of human history. Then what happened in the 17th century in Europe where states sort of took over that? And that's an interesting story. And we're kind of evolving backwards to that earlier time. But the way they did it is they outlawed all private force. Say there's only going to be one sheriff in town, he works for us. And we have our own standing army, which is very expensive, by the way. Standing armies are very expensive. But I think what's happening, if we start using letters of marque, we're just going to hasten that devolution back to the status quo ante of the Westphalian system. Last comments? I mean, certainly I was provocative enough to have something to say, yeah.
So is your general outlook kind of like having these mercenaries is what we make of it?
No, my general outlook is that There's a great deal of people who are in denial mode about this. This is a huge security trend happening under our feet that's largely ignored. It doesn't have the flash, bang, whiz stuff of like, you know, tragic events like in Nice, France, or in Mosul. So it doesn't get CNN time, but I think this is a much more destabilizing trend than people give it credit for. And so my work as working, you know, the book I wrote for Oxford University Press, the novel I wrote, kind of want to showcase, like, this is a real deal. You can't outlaw it. It's too late for that. We're going to be seeing more and more of this. But the time to do something about that is now, and not in 2030, when you have a mercenary company take over a small state in Africa, and now has a seat at the United Nations. I mean, this happened in the Middle Ages, like Milan. Milan had a dynasty of mercenaries, the Sforza family. They took over Milan, and they were there, you know, the Mamluks in the Ottoman Empire, the same thing. And so, like, mercenaries, it's not just a bunch of guys in the jungle, you know, shooting at whatever. They have the power to have, like, just like there's narco states, there could be merco states, or something like that. So or they could, you know, what would ISIS do with a squadron of Mi-24 Hind helicopters for 2 weeks? You know, so that we're getting to that world. And I'm kind of worst-casing it a little bit, but I don't think it's unreasonable. And this stuff really is, you know, again, the novel's great immunity from having to be rigorous about some of this stuff. But I think the novel's more nonfiction than fiction. Yeah?
Why do you think it's too late to outlaw this type of thing, or start saying in an international forum, we would like there to be particular norms regarding the use of mercenaries, or you lay down domestic laws and you say, United States citizens, this is not a, you know, type of activity that we're going to have U.S. companies who are selling these types of services to actors who fall in category X.
Yeah.
So, like, what is the problem with doing that? Because as you were suggesting earlier,
mm-hmm.
the state system just kind of emerged, you know, in the, you know, 1700s and 1800s, and all of a sudden we said, okay, no longer are we going to have these mercenaries, we're going to privatize the use of force. What's the problem with saying that again?
Because I think, well, in the international level is law enforcement and political will. So there's a reason, why United States of America and Putin, which have pretty strong militaries, have still relied on private military industry, because they provide plausible deniability. Now, we know why Putin likes private military companies, but the reason we like them is because you can put boots on the ground anywhere in the world, and they don't count as boots on the ground if they're contractors. And people don't care about dead contractors. They care about dead Marines and dead soldiers. They don't care about dead contractors. So if you're the White House, whether you're Republican or Democrat, you want to keep this tool in your toolkit because it allows you to do stuff. It allows you to circumvent democratic accountability and force is what it does. Okay. So I think that's why we're not going to do it. Also, you have really ugly conversations. Like, well, if there's a law saying American citizens can't fight in other people's military units, then what about all the Americans who work for the Israeli Defense Force, right? How are they, you know, how a guy works for, you know, it gets really complicated really fast, legally, politically. Or we say you can work for some countries but not other countries' military. I mean, or military units. And in terms of, again, international, like, who's going to enforce this stuff? The United Nations in 2009 declared Blackwater, companies like Blackwater, to be mercenary and crickets, not crickets. So I think that's why I'm pessimistic. It's not just because it's based on actual, you know, 15 plus years of this industry, we still haven't seen it regulated. I mean, the manufacturer of toys has more regulation, the outsourcing military power. So, yeah.
You mentioned that this trend is kind of happening right under our feet, but we're distracted by these other things.
Yeah.
It seems like one of the challenges in drawing more attention to it is just figuring out a way to measure or demonstrate the nature of the trend. Or,
yeah.
You know, can you do that by showing how much money is in this, or in these efforts, or do you look at some kind of level of violence, or the number of groups, or what they're able to achieve, or how do you characterize?
No, this is indeed the question. And for those of you who are actually somewhat interested in this, this is the question I would give to you to challenge, because it's really hard to demonstrate this. It's like demonstrating the power of international narcotic organizations in the early years, right? I mean, this is all illicit stuff. You can't go to a Abu Dhabi and say, can you give me your, how many mercenaries are you hiring to whack Houthis in Yemen? They're not going to tell you that. the reason I was able to write some of this is because I was actually in the industry. I was an industry insider who then left to talk about it. And it's the reason I'm doing a novel is it's just easier to just sort of have a compelling story that's loosely based on reality than trying to document it, you know, Oxford University press style or Georgetown University press style. So this is indeed the challenge. It's like, how do you get data? In some ways, this industry is more secretive than the CIA or the Pentagon, because at least there you have oversight hearings in the Hill. There's FOIA you can do. Doesn't mean you're going to be successful, but there's some tools. If you walk on the door of these companies as a researcher, as a Georgetown University student, they'll come in, welcome, oh, you know Tom, well, yes, come in, of course, come. And they'll give you their talking points that they give to Congress, because they can lobby in ways that the US Army can't lobby, and they do. But if you ask any hard questions, the door is over there. And that's it, you're cut off. And what happens then is you have people like Jeremy Scahill, who's a reporter, you know, who plays fast and loose with facts and looks for sensationalism, portray the industry, and that becomes the public, you know, record. And that's more, it does more harm than good. I mean, he's not a scholar like you. He's out there to sell books. One of the problems that this industry has is there's so much myth-making. There's knee-jerk left-wing and right-wing reactions that people can't even get. They're done with the debate, or it's sort of like Trump Clinton, if I could go there, and people at some level people are like done. They've made up their mind. That's it. They don't want to open. They're no longer open for discussion. This industry is a little bit that way too. But I would encourage everybody, if you're at all remotely interested in this topic, to think about, are there ways to capture information about this and analyze it? Because it is a gap in the literature on this. It's desperately needed. It's also a gap in policy thinking on this. It doesn't have to be academic literature. It could be a smart white paper at a think tank or something. That is what's needed. And to help move our strategic imagination forward a bit to encompass at least the possibility that some of this may be relevant. I'm not here to sell you all on this stuff. I didn't even talk about my novel that much. It's just the idea that warfare as we know it is changing, and it may look very different than the war that we like to imagine. Yeah.
In your previous book, you documented the success that private military corporations had on executive outcomes in Sierra Leone and being military professional, MPRI. Croatia and Bosnia. How do you think, hypothetically, the war in Syria would have evolved had, say, the U.S. government hired Time Corp?
People are saying, let's hire these companies to whack ISIS. So, people look at Boko Haram, what those mercenaries did against Boko Haram, saying, let's do that against Shabaab, let's do that against ISIS. I don't know how successful they would be. Because one of the problems of this space is full sort of BS. You know, a lot of charlatans in this space. And I don't want to pull punches about that. I think the problem, I think, that you could have put a bounty on ISIS and just let people go for it. I mean, Erbil right now in the notionally Kurdistan is like, Erbil is like an area where like a lot of lone wolf mercenaries show up. And it's like that space bar scene from Star Wars and Tatooine. You know, that's what Erbil's like these days. And you could just put out like, the US government could just put $500 a head on ISIS. And no, to your earlier point, like, we'll just turn our heads away for collateral damage, you know? I can't imagine that would be a good idea, but you know that has been proposed in the last year and a half, 2 years. I think it would complicate already a complex situation, but it could happen. I mean, I don't know. I mean, rich countries have access to this stuff, and that's like the Gulf states. The problem is the Gulf states are putting a lot of ISIS fighters up in the field too. That's a different story. Next question.
All right. As it stands now, private military companies, which mostly rely on recruiting former, you know, military people,
yes,
trained by states. Do you foresee a shift in that to more in-house training?
That's good. So people have asked me this. This is a good question. Like, right now, I don't see it right now, but it's possible. So what's happening is, first of all, warlords are adopting this model, and they're putting up a shingle saying, we're now a private military firm, we can secure you NGO if you're going to go to Somalia, and they do. This is what's going on. The U.S. Army hires, in the past, have hired warlords who have a private military company to secure logistics routes in Afghanistan. And of course, the way they do it is pretty heavy-handed. I mean, don't tell General Dubik, you know? And I'm not defending or justifying that. I think that right now it's still cheaper for them to hire. There's a surplus of military labor on the market. I mean, not only is it just coming on national militaries, but when the U.S. hired this industry in the last 15 years in Iraq and Afghanistan, they created this global labor pool of people who are connected and know how to do this stuff. And that labor pool is looking for new work. And the problem is that we think, the U.S. government, like Pentagon, thinks that when we're done with Blackwater or DynCorp or whatever, they'll just go away because we're done with them and they'll just go bankrupt or change their business model. Well, that's not what happens. They're profit maximizing entities. They look for other work. Not those companies, because they're sugar daddies, the U.S. government, but they hire subcontractors who then go and look for other. And they also, most of the people who work for those companies when I was in the industry were not even Americans. And they're going back home to the Philippines, to Mexico, to wherever, to Botswana, to Uganda. Uganda is a huge hub of this stuff right now. I mean, so it's this industry is already globalized. And they still, I don't think they need to hire, they don't need to have basic training of their own because there's still enough people out there to get by.
You know, I'm just puzzling over this. First of all, I think what I said about China, if we could incorporate China into some kind of an accommodation, a sizable chunk of the global population would sort of be stabilized and there would be order and you wouldn't have any of this. This is really a mark of either weakness like Russia or political disorder like Africa. So Clausewitz says if you're going to use force, don't use it until you have a vision of where you want to be. So now we're going to start to use all of this. What's our vision of the world we're using these instruments to acquire, to achieve?
So from a USG perspective?
Yeah.
We don't have one. So the reason why, this is my opinion, so in Iraq and Afghanistan, over 50% of our military personnel were outsourced. Now most of the, only about 10% of those were trigger pullers. Most of them were, the mass majority were people who made food and stuff like that, completely harmless contractors. I think the reason why, when we started those wars in 2003, they were envisioned to be quick and easy, not 2 10-year wars. And with an all-volunteer army, we could not recruit enough volunteers to do all those billets. And so we increasingly outsourced it. And also, part of the Reagan Revolution, the Thatcher Revolution, is that some things are better outsourced to the private sector than try to have bureaucrats do it or public sector do it. So there was that mentality as well. And I think it was, there was no vision, it was like a mission creep situation. And I think if we use these now in a very deliberate way, I think I don't think the Pentagon would do that. I think the Pentagon's resistant against this type of stuff. But we still rely on contractors a great deal. There's a 3-to-1 ratio in Afghanistan today of contractors to USG personnel. So we're still doing,
most contractors, though, are logisticians. They're supply. The war-fighting contractors are a very small minority.
That's right, 10%.
But what you're describing is sort of perpetual disorder.
Yes. Yeah, these are factors that encourage disorder globally. And
the solution is the imposition of some superior political power. The nation state in 1648.
That would be one. I mean, there's three options, I think, to what do we do with this industry? I don't think you can regulate it. You could buy out the market for force. You could, as a great power as 1648 did. That's because mercenaries were so used in the 30 Years' War and wrought so much destruction that I think that there was just some general consensus that, okay, I'd rather have a tyrannical king over me than this band of mercenaries. I don't see, who's going to do that in Africa and South Asia and other places, I don't know, or the Middle East. You could also try to use market mechanisms in the market force by trying to reward good behavior and punish bad behavior. To do that, you need an element, somebody with market power, like the United States or the United Nations, who could set rules of the road and enforce them. And then I think the third is you just is a co we have right now, which is just, you know, nobody's doing anything about it, which I think is the most dangerous one of all. Because now it's just going to creep along, and then suddenly one day it's going to poof, it's a big deal. So I'm, you know, I raised this not to be flippant. I mean, it's interesting novel material, but it's not, I'm not pushing it. These are all forces for disorder, and I don't know if, you know, I'm not sure who's going to establish, you know, lay down the law on this stuff globally. That's my concern.
Yeah.
But somebody here will figure this out. Somebody will hear.
Yeah, that will solve.
It'll be a paper, and it'll be brilliant, and it'll be a Nobel Peace Prize or a literature prize or something like that.
So next semester.
Next semester. Yeah, you'll get until May to figure this out. All right.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.